Chair, Honorable Ministers of Education from the invited countries, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, I thank the Honorable Minister of Human Resources Development, Government of India, for inviting me and our delegation to this conference. I am pleased to have the opportunity to present you our thoughts on the centrality of women's literacy, inclusive and participative development on behalf of the delegation of Sri Lanka. There is a well-known saying that when you educate a woman, you educate the whole country. The statement alone underscores the importance of the centrality of women's literacy to inclusive and participative development. It is a fact that women in Sri Lanka are not discriminated on grounds of gender. It is ensured by the Constitution granting to all its citizens, male and female, the right to education. It has been reinformed by the grant of free education a good six decades ago in 1945, even before independence, further supporting state action such as pre-tuition, pre-schooling, pre-test books, pre-uniforms, pre-midday meals, too needly, subsidized transport, the special education for the differently abled have resulted in the raise of literacy rate, which were 46% in 1950 to 92.5 today, and the literacy rate of 96 to the 15 to 25 age group. The 1978 Constitution by Articles 12.2 took precautionary steps, verbalizing what has been already prevailing by stating that no citizen shall be discriminated against the grounds of sex. Education for 5 to 14 groups was made mandatory by Compulsory Education Act of 1998. There was no gender discrimination in these. More women enter the universities than men. In terms of actual numbers, science does not seem to be a popular option with women undergraduates. What seems to affect women education seems to have more to do with socioeconomic and regional factors than gender itself. The case of women, so to say, have received positive state support. The Sri Lankan Women's Charter was established in 1993, and the National Committee on Women has been set up since 1995. Legal reforms have been instituted in relation to numerous issues concerning the protection of rights of women. Despite these measures and the increasing levels of female who serve to key academic position and as professional in varied fields, low participation of women in the legislation at policymaking level has continued up to date. The vision of His Excellency President of Sri Lanka, the Mahinda Chintan, has pledged to increase number of nomination to women to minimum of 25% the total number of candidates in respect of provincial council and local councils. The women in usually expected to be responsible for the affairs of home, a custodian with the authority passing into the further. Custom and traditional place burden domestic chores on women, which also confine them, their homes in varying degrees. Restriction on female mobility and autonomy are stronger among Muslim and Tamil communities. In general, women have moderate degree, financial independence in Sri Lanka. They have access to land and property. A study conducted by the International Center for Research on Women shows that most women acquired their assets, both land and property, through inheritance, with purchase being the second main source for ownership. Women have become a property owners through government land distribution programs. Women have equal assets to bank loans, mortgages, and other forms of credit from various of sources, such as the state, private financial institution, donor assistance, or local credit delivery programs. Most women are employed in the informal sector. Poverty coupled with occasions of male domination make it difficult for them to challenge or change their situation. Increased opportunities to education have given many women employment in independent incomes, which have contributed not only to the economic empowerment of women, but also to more equitable gender relations. It is estimated that women in Sri Lanka have only attained 69 of the level of human development of men, because their share in income is only 35, and their representation in the country in political system in only 31%. Due to the present economic circumstances, women from these low-income families continue to seek employment in Middle Eastern countries. It is a factor to be reckoned with, as it has far-reaching socio-economic health implications. Several studies have highlighted negative aspects of such migration, both to women and family. The Sri Lanka Foreign Employment Bureau has taken measures to minimize to negative aspects, prevent economic exploitation and abuse. Admittedly, much more need to be done. The legal age of marriage in Sri Lanka is 18, both for men and women. Earlier marriage is less common than other South Asian countries, but it does occur in some community in entering religion beliefs, cultural practice.
Thank you very much. You also have 2 more minutes, yeah. So we'll appreciate.
Only 2 minutes,
tell us,
please.
The highlights.
2004 UN report estimated that 7% of Sri Lanka girls between 15 to 19 were either married, divorced, or widows. Recent judicial development has reduced discrimination against women in the event of divorce by taking away custody rights so far enjoyed by men. Challenge ahead of us. Poverty reduction programs must focus more on women. Women's legal and reproductive rights must be ensured. Health of adolescent workers and aging women must be promoted. Victimizing of domestic abuse, violence must be stopped. Issues related to skills employment in the rural sector must be addressed. Poverty in the agriculture sector must be increased. Work conditions in the manufacturing sector must be monitored. Finally, in the teaching and learning process, the knowledge of social cohesion, respect for each other and for environment, knowledge of the health issues, economy, and the society must be inculcated in the all students. This is in effect of life skills education, no education for sustainable development. Thank you.
Thank you very much.